Hello students, welcome to EPG Paathshala. I am Dr. Rajiv Jain from Jivaji University, Gwalior. Today we are going to discuss about a module, National Biosafety Policies and Regulatory Framework under the paper Environmental Biotechnology. Learning objectives in this module are managing the environmental regulations and safety, managing federal regulations and toxic substances, regulations affecting chemical manufacturing and use. We will also study regulatory overview, process technology safety and hazard analysis, material safety data sheets, regulatory framework. So here, how to manage the environment, managing the environmental regulations and safety, how to manage them. Managing environmental and safety issues is challenging, time-consuming and expensive. Being responsible for these matters is more than just saving money and protecting the company. The environmental and health and safety managers must also protect him or herself, because the current laws make the individual personally liable for any wrongdoing, even if there is no malicious intent. Pollution control generally involves preventing the facility from harming people or the environment and mitigating the effect of any pollutant emissions. Harm to people or the environment is difficult to prove, so regulations are increasingly designed and stringent to eliminate contamination. Effluent standards are based on health effects studies, but because of factors such as cancers, long latency period, and the lack of human exposure data, standards generally include a large safety factor. The environmental managers must recognize that there is a little margin for error when it comes to contamination issues. It is also important to recognize that erring on the side of safety is usually the least expensive and most legally defensible position in the long run. Taking that position can lead an organization or company to more efficient use of raw materials, recycling, and other waste minimization tactics. However, such a program requires balance. Risks cannot be eliminated, and too much error on the side of safety can result in costly overkill. The safety manager is called upon to manage both risk and resources. Managing hazardous materials generally involves the following four major issues: identification, storage and handling, disposal and shipping, and record keeping. An industrial facility that does not have programs addressing all of the four of these issues should essentially not be handling hazardous materials. The environmental and health safety manager, as an occupational safety professional, OSP, must know what his or her facility is purchasing, generating, storing, treating, and disposing of in order to effectively satisfy the cradle-to-grave provisions of Resource Conservation and Recovery Act, called as RCRA. Good record keeping and communication are essential to several key elements of any pollution control and prevention program: emergency procedures, contingency planning, and employee training. For example, If a caustic line from a plating operating building breaks, how is the waste material kept out of the storm sewer in order to prevent a national pollutant discharge eliminating system violation, and how large can the spill be before it constitutes a reportable quantity under CERCLA, that is Comprehensive Environmental Response Compensation and Liability Act. Contingency plans must describe actions the facility will take to minimize hazards in the event of a release, and employees must be trained to respond appropriately. Well-run organizations are those which have established formal safety and hazardous material management programs. These programs establish corporate policy which addresses pertinent aspects of OSHA, TSCA, that is Toxic Substance Control Act, CERCLA, SARA, and RCRA, the Hazardous Material Transportation Act, HMTA, and other applicable regulations. The need for an integrated program and policy uniting everything from purchasing through use and disposal can be demonstrated by considering what happens if a hazardous material is purchased or generated without knowledge of the regulations. OSHA regulations could be violated because precautions for employee exposure are not taken. SARA could be violated because the requirement for notification of the presence of listed material has not been met, and RCRA regulations could be violated if waste from the material is not stored or disposed of properly. There are also potential violations of other acts such as the Clean Air Act and Clean Water Act. The OSP must become integrated into all aspects of a facility's operations. A properly informed OSP helps limit the amount of hazardous material stored on-site, monitors the use of the material so that right-to-know regulations are not violated, and assesses the rate at which a waste is generated to minimize spill potential and storage and disposal difficulties. Disposal issues are increasingly important because federal regulations are dynamic or changing. Waste minimization requirements and land disposal ban are making waste production more expensive. RCRA requires that storage locations should be specific. There must be spill contaminant supplies for cleanup, controlled access, and segregation of incompatible materials. In addition, RCRA holds that a hazardous waste storage data area cannot be subject to a 100-year flood. Both on the job training and the written training program are necessary. Fines may result if the training is not properly documented and employees are not tested for competency. The OSP must also be concerned with problem of acquisition and diversity. A company cannot control pollution or its hazardous waste by selling contaminated properties or assets. However, it can certainly add to its liability by purchasing contaminated property. Unfortunately, many companies already own contaminated property with projected remedial actions that may cost millions of dollars. The OSP may be called upon to plan, negotiate, and manage these expensive and complicated hazardous waste cleanups. Too often, remedial action contracts permit a consultant to design and build with little or no oversight. If such contracts are not managed properly, cost overruns and disputes can be expected. Bidders must be pre-qualified Control documents must be precise and accurate. There must be a management plan that includes numerous inspections and thorough documentation. There must also be emergency plans in the event that something goes wrong, such as a spill, a fire, or explosion. Here, next thing we shall study, managing federal regulations and toxic substances. Toxic substances can create pervasive environmental and public health problems. The sheer volume of toxic materials manufactured and the many avenues of exposure, occupational, which may be occupational, consumer use, and environmental residues greatly increase the unacceptable health and environmental risk from many of these substances. Public policy has traditionally been aimed at protecting the public from toxic substances. For example, during the later half of the 19th century, federal laws were passed to prohibit the adulteration of patent medicines, to require the content of certain consumer products to be truthfully labeled, and to regulate the transportation of explosives. While there were early attempts at federal protection of the environment, it was not until the 1970s that environmental protection becomes a priority. A labyrinth of federal laws were enacted to control the public exposure to toxic substances, thereby minimizing potential risk to public health and the environment. These federal statutes cover five broad areas: occupational protection statutes, laws on transporting chemicals and hazardous substances, chemical use and assessment laws, environmental protection statutes, and laws regulating cleanup of unintentional disposal of chemicals. There are a number of federal statutes that address toxic substances. However, the major laws are the Federal Food, Drug and Cosmetic Act, FFDCA, Federal Insecticide, Fungicide and Rodenticide Act, FIFRA, Clean Air Act, CAA, Clean Water Act, CWA, Occupational Safety and Health Act, OSH Act, Safe Drinking Water Act, SDWA, Hazardous Materials Transportation Act, HMTA, Toxic Substances Control Act, TSCA, Resource Conservation and Recovery Act, RCRA, Comprehensive Environmental Response, Compensation and Liability Act, CERCLA, Superfund Amendments and Reauthorization Act, SARA. These laws and their broad areas they cover are summarized in Table 1. Occupational Safety Issues. The Occupational Safety and Health Act is the primary federal law regulating toxic substances to protect workers in the workplace. The federal law was passed as the result of increased public concern about the workplace hazards and the effects of exposure to hazardous chemicals. Before passage of the law, worker safety was the responsibility of state agencies and labor groups. Federal safety requirements were confined to specific industries, for example, mining, railroading, longshoring, etc. The Occupational Safety and Health Administration, OSH, OSHA, was established within the Labor Department to administer the Act. The main provisions of the Act dealing with toxic substances include establishing and enforcing standards to limit exposure to various chemical substances that could induce acute or chronic health effects, regulating substances that may cause cancer, informing employees of the dangers posed by toxic substances through the use of material safety data sheets, MSDSS, requiring employers to maintain medical training and other records to track the development and incidence of occupationally induced diseases. OSHA has established standards for 22 toxic or hazardous substances and 402 toxic air contaminants. In setting standards, OSHA evaluates three types of health effects: acute, that is immediate, chronic, long-term, and carcinogenicity, ability to cause cancer. Pursuant to the United States Supreme Court ruling in Industrial Union Department, AFL-CIO versus American Petroleum Institute, OSHA must show that a significant risk exists before it issues a health standard. Also, under the Supreme Court's ruling in American Textile Manufacturer Institute versus Donovan, a standard must be feasible, that is, must adequately assure that no employee will suffer material impairment to their health to the extent that this is capable of being done. OSHA standards include, say, permissible exposure limit, PEL, labeling, protection, equipment, control procedures, and monitoring requirements. SARA establishes specific training requirement funds, training programs, and delegates responsible to OSHA and the National Institute of Environmental Health Sciences. SARA requires 40 hours of classroom and 24 hours of site-specific training for nearly all workers on hazardous waste site cleanups. At commercial hazardous waste treatment, storage, and disposal facilities, and for industrial workers who will act as hazardous materials first responders, OSHA has promulgated data regulations to cover the SARA training and working condition requirements. Environmental protection issues. In the 1970s, Congress passed several environmental protection statutes, beginning with the Clean Air Act and amendments to the Federal Water Pollution Control Act, after that renamed as the Clean Water Act. While most of these initiatives were actually amendments to existing federal environment statutes dating back 70 years, the changes were so extensive in both philosophy and scope that they are commonly thought as of new laws. These laws focus primarily on cleaning up conventional pollutants, smoke and sulfur oxides in the air, oxygen depleting discharges into surface water, and solid waste into the land. As the 1970s ended, these laws began to focus on toxic substances that could threaten human health at even low concentrations. These statutes were amended, or new regulations and policies to handle toxins were adopted by the administering agency. Unlike the Occupational Safety and Health Act, environmental laws address by product discharges of toxic and hazardous substances that are released into the environment. Standards to reduce risk to public are established in a similar manner to the OSHA OSH Act. All of the environmental laws are administered by the United States Environmental Protection Agency, EPA. The Clean Air Act originally addressed smoke, dirty air that plagued many industrial cities. It was subsequently amended to add provisions about the effect of sources of pollution. The 1977 amendments focused the statute on toxic air emissions. The Clean Air Act gives the EPA the responsibility to set three different kinds of air standards. First is National Ambient Air Quality Standards, defining the maximum concentration of air pollutants allowable. new source performance standards, NSPS, establishing the allowable emission levels for different stationary sources, national emissions standards for hazardous air pollutants, setting emission limitations for which no ambient air quality standards exist. National ambient air quality standards authorized under Section 109 include both primary and secondary standards. Primary standards reflect the concentration level necessary to protect public health. Secondary standards are designed to protect public welfare from any known or anticipated adverse effect of air emissions on vegetation, soil, water, visibility, or climate. The Clean Air Act established emission standards for specific air pollutants that are particularly hazardous to health. Emission limits based on the best available control technology, BACT, are imposed on both existing and new sources. In setting hazardous air pollutant standards, EPA must consider both the beneficial and adverse economic, environmental, and energy impact associated with the standard. The Clean Water Act, the CWA, controls the discharge of toxic discharges into surface streams. The first national effort to control water pollutants was through the Rivers and Harbors Act, which prohibited discharges into navigable waterways that could interfere with transportation. Discharge permits, as part of the National Pollutant Discharge Elimination System, set enforceable limitations on the types and quantities of pollutants which may be discharged. The 1972 Act required the EPA to establish effluent standards for toxic pollutants. EPA was slow to develop these standards, and environmental groups sued to force promulgation. A consent decree in the case of NRDC versus Train imposed a schedule for the EPA to develop such effluent limitations. The law decree was subsequently adopted in the 1977 amendments to the law. The EPA is required to promulgate toxic discharge requirements for 34 industrial categories covering 129 toxic pollutants. The 129 toxic include metals, volatile compounds, corrosives, and pesticides. Discharge of these pollutants are required to use best available technology economically achievable. Toxic and hazardous wastes are generated primarily from industries and farmlands. Industries discharging directly into the surface streams are regulated by a so-called NPDES permit. Discharges into municipal sewer plants are required to meet pre-treatment standards. Non-point sources such as farmlands are controlled through the encouragement of erosion control. While the CWA focused on surface water quality, the Safe Drinking Water Act, SDWA, was passed in 1975 and amended in 1986 to protect groundwater and drinking water resources. The law requires EPA to establish recommended maximum contaminant goals, RMCG, for each contaminant which may have an adverse effect on the health of an individual. Two types of drinking water standards were established to limit the amount of contamination that may be in drinking water. Primary standards with the maximum contaminant level, MCL, to protect human health, and secondary standards that involve the color, taste, smell, or other physical characteristics of drinking water sources. The SWA regulates 83 different contaminants, which includes 14 volatile organic compounds, 29 synthetic organic compounds, 13 inorganic chemicals, 4 microbiological contaminants, and 2 radiological contaminants. A second major provision of the SDWA for the purpose of protecting groundwater is the regulation of underground injection of toxic chemicals. Injection of liquid waste into underground wells is used as a means of disposal. Controls were needed to assure that this means of disposal did not damage the quality of aquifers. Five classes of underground injection wells were established. Class 4 wells were hazardous waste are injected into or above a formation within 1/4 mile of an underground source of drinking water were phased out. Under the 1986 amendment, states adopted a program for wellhead protection. A program addressed the surface and subsurface surrounding a well or well field through which contaminants are reasonably likely to move towards a well. Perhaps one of the most controversial and sometimes misunderstood environmental statute passed is the Resource Conservation and Recovery Act, RCRA. Regulation affecting chemical manufacturing and use. The general public often view environmental laws as having their focus on the effect of toxic and hazardous substances being emitted into the workplace and or the environment at the point of manufacture. However, both the public and the environment can also be exposed to toxic substances during the use and applications of chemicals. To reduce the risk of exposure through the use of a chemical, a number of federal laws were enacted aimed at regulating what specific chemical can be manufactured and sold. One of the earliest federal legislation aimed at regulating the manufacture of chemicals is the Federal Food, Drug and Cosmetic Act, FFDCA. The act provides the regulatory authority for the Food and Drug Administration, FDA, to assure the safety of food, drugs, medical devices, and cosmetics. Adulteration or misbranding of any of these consumer products is strictly prohibited. The FDA establishes standards that must be met by manufacturers before certain products may be sold. Pre-marketing clearances are based on scientific data submitted by manufacturers to demonstrate that the proposed product will not have an adverse effect on human health. Major provisions of the law include the following: the banning of intentional addition of substances known to cause cancer in animals to food products, the establishment of procedures for setting safety limits for pesticide residues on raw agriculture products, the required pre-use of safety assessments and approvals of all food additives. Another consumer-oriented federal legislation is the Federal Insecticide, Fungicide and Rodenticide Act, which established a regulatory program to control the manufacture and use of pesticides and related products whose purpose is to kill, repel or control insects, rodents, plants, trees, algae, fungi, bacteria or other living organisms. The first federal legislation to control chemical pesticides was passed in 1910. Like the FFDCA, the early laws were aimed against adulterating or misbranding chemical pesticides to protect consumers against false advertising. Next thing is process technology safety and hazards analysis. Employees must develop and maintain certain information about their processes. It is this process safety information that must be communicated to employees who are involved in the processes. The information is intended to provide a foundation for identifying, understanding the hazards involved in the process. The purpose of the process safety information requirement is to provide an adequate data base to support that requirement elements of process safety management program, PSI, is needed. to document formally the as-built, as-modified condition of the plant, to provide the necessary data with which to perform the required hazard analysis, to provide the necessary data to support other process, safety management policy, procedure and practice elements such as standard operating procedures and emergency response and management of change procedures, to communicate information on hazardous substance to employees and others as required by state or federal regulations. In the last, I shall discuss regulatory framework. Proper waste management begins with the determining the minimum requirements for waste management at a facility for assessing three factors: the federal regulations, the state enforcement policies of hazardous waste regulations, and the general liabilities of the facility. Although commonly a manager will approach his decision in that order, the best managers prepare their company policy considering the factors in the opposite order. The federal waste management requirements, the basic rules necessary to follow. These are regulations developed from the Resource Conservation and Recovery Act and its subsequent amendments. A waste manager must determine first whether the facility operates in a manner covered by these regulations. If so, is it comply with the regulations? The changing of federal regulations to protect surface water and air quality from toxic chemicals also can change a hazardous waste manager's options for treatment and disposal. This susceptibility to regulatory changes is one factor a manager must consider in evaluating major capital investment for waste treatment or disposal equipment. For those states authorized to conduct inspections and enforcement of the federal RCRA program, it is the state regulators who make the determinations of whether a particular waste has the characteristics of hazardous waste, whether sampling was adequate, whether the operation is adequate, and what are the penalties for non-compliance. As much as the Federal Environmental Protection Agency encourages uniformity, there can be variation in the interpretation from state to state. Finally, and what wise waste manager considers first when designing a waste strategy, present and future liability has become of paramount importance. So, students, let us summarize what we have learned in this module. In the present module, we have learned management of environmental, and also we have considered various safety issues and regulatory framework, which involves proper waste management, determining the minimum requirements for waste management at a facility, and also to protect the public from the effect of different types of pollutants, which this we have studied today. Thank you, students.